لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا
وأذن في الناس بالحج يأتوك رجالا وعلى كل ضامر يأتين من كل فج عميق وأتموا الحج والعمرة لله فإن
إلهنا ما أعد لك مليك كل من ملك لبيك قد لبيت لك لبيك إن الحمد لله
الحمد لله الحمد لله وصلاة وسلام رسول الله وعلى آله ومن والاه. Inshallah, we will continue our series of the call for Hajj. This specific episode will address the 10th of Zulhijjah, also known as Yawm al-Nahr or the Day of Sacrifice. As you may have heard in the previous video, we are departing basically from Muzdalifah after performing our Fajr Salat, and we are going towards Mina. My respected brothers and sisters, remember to continue to do Adhkar and recite Talbiyah as much as possible, inshallah, as we are going towards Mina. The 10th of Zulhijjah is known as Yawm al-Nahr or the Day of Sacrifice. This is a day that is full of action. In fact, when I look at the different Ayyam al-Hajj, the days of Hajj, this seems to stand out as a day that has the most action in it. For us, it's Yawm al-Nahr, and for the people across the globe, this is the day of Eid for them. Once again, for us, this is Yawm al-Nahr, but for the people across the globe, our loved ones, our family members, and the Muslims across the globe who are not doing Hajj, this is the day of Eid for them. Our day will consist of four specific actions. The first one is the pelting of the pebbles at the Jamarat, and the second action is the sacrificing of an animal on that day, meaning our Hadi, and the third action will be the Halaq or the Taqsir, and the fourth action is Tawaf al-Ifada. My respected brothers and sisters, there is a difference of opinion among the scholars in terms of whether or not the order is compulsory. According to Imam al-Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayh, he said that the order is not compulsory. However, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayh and some of the other madhahib, they say that the order of the actions on the day of Yawm al-Nahr is something that is wajib, meaning one must go from Muzdalifah to Mina, pelt the stones first, then they get the news of their hadi being sacrificed, and then after that they will do halaq or taqsir, and then after that they will go for tawaf al-ifada. My respected brothers and sisters, we should try our best, inshallah, to be able to do the different actions on the day of Yawm al-Nahr, the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah, in order as much as possible. Let us go back to the coming from Muzdalifah to Mina. So there are some groups or some people try to attempt to walk from Muzdalifah to Mina. We highly discourage this, and there are a number of reasons for this. Number one, when we divide the group into two, there is no guarantee that the group who does not basically have the leadership with them, for example, or the group that is on foot will be able to find the tent. We do not want, and we've heard many horror stories like this, that even if the people growing, walking towards Mina, they walk towards Mina, but when they reach the tent city, now they cannot find their tent. Sometimes, subhanAllah, we've heard horror stories where people are spending 2 to 3 hours literally walking in circles just to find their tent. But if we go in the bus, we are taken directly from Muzdalifah to Mina, and in front or right besides or near our tent, and inshallah, when we reach there full of energy. Other reason why we discourage people to walk from Muzdalifah to Mina is the fact that it is a number of kilometers. And we have to keep a number of things in mind. The environment that is in Arabia is not an environment that any North American is used to. The environment and the sun and the heat and the grime and the dirt is not something we're used to. We're not used to that. Number one. Number two, we're not used to wearing slippers. As we know, there are conditions for the slippers that Hujjaj can wear. We're not used to wearing those kind of slippers. We're not in our joggers, in our runners. And sometimes it's so sad. You'll see someone wearing, mashallah, Nike and Air Jordans, and they think they're doing their Hajj. But my respected brothers and sisters, there are conditions. We must wear a certain type of slipper, especially for the men. So if we're wearing that type of slipper, I can tell you, believe you me, it's very, very uncomfortable. And the problem is, if we're used to it, no problem. If we're not used to it, yay, whoopee, alhamdulillah, I made it to my tent and I'm full of energy right now. But a lot of times we notice that the very same day or the next day, the people's feet are swollen because we're not used to trekking in that kind of an environment. So in the different challenges, sometimes subhanAllah, people have jazba and they want to go and they have the fervor, and subhanAllah, they end up fainting. Literally, there is not one, there is hundreds of stories. They end up fainting, they end up getting lost, they end up taking so many rests. Everyone has already reached there. The 2-hour trek now has become a 6-hour trek. Ambulance get involved. My respected brothers and sisters, we are trying our best to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fulfill each and every single one of His command to the best of our ability in as smooth as possible. So the golden rule simply is, go listen to the leadership of your Hajj group. If a bus is arranged, and most of the time buses are arranged, inshallah the bus will take you from Muzdalifah to Mina. Once again, we highly discourage you to walk towards basically Mina. Then again, if you want to, you're doing it at your own risk. But we highly discourage that you walk towards Mina. And I have, I think, provided ample evidence of why we should not do that. Someone can argue and say, brother, I'm doing Hajj once in a lifetime. I want to do Hajj exactly how the Prophet did it. I want to walk. I want to do a walking Hajj. My respected brothers and sisters, we have heard this from many people, even young, strong people, mashallah, who are young and strong and full of fervor. But when we see them, when they have arrived to Mina, we don't see them smiling. They seem to be upset, and they seem to be very angry and upset at their decision. So we're asking you humbly, inshallah, when you do go with the bus, inshallah, you follow the leadership of your group, and inshallah, from there, we were moving from Muzdalifah to Mina. A point comes to mind that the Prophet ﷺ, even some ahadith we see that he used his camel to travel from different places during the Ayyam al-Hajj. In fact, even ahadith indicate that he, at one point, he even used a camel to do tawaf, which means when there is a mode of transportation that can make it easier for us to be able to travel from place to place, then why not adopt it? Because the asl is not mashaqqa. The asl, meaning the main core or the main point, is not mashaqqa and difficulty. The main point is fulfilling the different aspects of Hajj and the different rites of Hajj. May Allah give us, inshallah, tawfiq one and all. Now, inshallah, as we have mentioned the 4 different actions which we do on that day, let us start discussing the first item, inshallah, on that list, and that is Rami, the pelting of the Jamarat. My respected brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, by now you have already collected your stones. You have your stones with you, inshallah. When you reach your tent in Mina, it's not compulsory that you need to go straight from your tent to now pelt the Jamarat. It's not compulsory. What we would recommend is that you take your time and you rest. Remember, you have so much ibad that is left for you to do. So take your rest, rest as much as possible, inshallah. And when you are well rested, you drank your water, you have rested, then inshallah, you can go and pelt and do your first, inshallah, of multiple ramis, inshallah, of the Jamarat. My respected brothers and sisters, another point here. So I know that the in terms of the madhab of some of the scholars, one must do the pelting and the rami before dhuhr. And I do understand that that mas'ala exists. But we have always found that our fuqaha have always been understanding and have always understood the complexities of these masail. And context is extremely important. Remember, the pelting of the stone in the past, if you just try to contextualize this, we're talking about thousands of years ago, was done basically, even 150, 200 years ago, was done maybe by 100,000 people maximum, maybe 56,000 people. Now we're talking about 2.5 million to 3 million people. And sometimes it's not possible for you to be able, even sometimes you see from the North American camps, you've started now you're going towards the pelting of the Jamarat. Sometimes just that trek itself is taking you 2.5-3 hours because there is crowd, then there is crowd control, there is stop, go, exit. The police and the security and the khuddam of the Hajjaj, they're doing this on purpose for your safety. They don't want to hear incidents of trampling, of people getting killed because they're going for Rami. So my respected brothers and sisters, when we arrive for Rami, we don't need to Mina and we want to go for Rami. We can rest if we want, inshallah, and we can, inshallah, go after Dhuhr. We can go after Asr as long as we do it before Maghrib. Subhanallah, some of the scholars have gone so far to say you have all the time, especially for women and the weak and the sick, you have all the time to do your Rami even until the Fajr of the 11th the next day. Subhanallah. So when we have that tawsi' there, we have the mas'ala of doing before Dhuhr, we have the mas'ala of getting it done before Maghrib, we have the mas'ala and we have the tawsi' and the ability to do it the next day before Fajr. I'm not saying that we should adopt that, but we have that ability. Why not adopt what is the most easiest in terms of your physical health for you and for the entire group? This is why, inshallah, when we do get there, if we get there early enough, which generally doesn't happen because of all the delays, and there is one group of people going before Dhuhr, inshallah, the ones who want to go before Dhuhr, go ahead, inshallah, go with a group of brothers and sisters and go and do your pelting. We don't recommend it, but go with a group. Do not go alone, one or two people only. Go with a group, go, inshallah, and come back. However, generally speaking, we usually like to plan something around, you know, Asr time or before Maghrib time, that the entire group has rested, and now, inshallah, we can go together and we can go do the Rami. Now, what is the significance of Rami? I don't want to go into too many details here. Inshallah, later on, I will be exploring Rami from a spiritual point of view. But sometimes we have the misconception that I'm stoning the actual shaitan. We think the shaitan is hiding behind that stone. And mashallah, the bigger rock I throw, my slipper, and I throw something nice and big, it's going to smash shaitan right in his head. And he's going to be bleeding. My respected brothers and sisters, that's just not true. The Jamarat are basically a representation of the different places at which shaitan tried to dissuade Ibrahim alayhi salam from sacrificing his son. It's simply a symbolic place. So it's when we go there, we remember the time when the shaitan tried to dissuade Ibrahim alayhi salam, and we're simply stoning that. That's why the Jamarat, if you look at the 1980s and 90s, and maybe even early 2000s, it was very, very thin. Now they have taken that same Jamarat and they have expanded it to be so wide that literally 4,000 or 5,000 people can pelt almost at the same time simultaneously. Why? Because this is symbolic. For that reason, they made it easier for the Hujjaj. So my respected brothers and sisters, now you and I in the group, we're moving towards the Jamarat. And as we move towards the Jamarat, remember on the first day, we're only pelting the Jamarat al-Aqaba, only the biggest of the Jamarat. That's the only one that we'll be pelting on that day. And we will pelt it, inshallah, with seven pebbles. So we look into our pouch or into the bottle, we take out seven pebbles, and we simply, the action is not to throw it like this. The action is simply to keep it in your hands and simply throw it over like this, or simply if you can do it like this, you put the rock here and you simply flick it over, because the distance between you and the Jamarat are very close. Be very careful, my respected brothers and sisters, of not throwing your seven stones from a distance, because if by accident you miss, MashaAllah, any Hazrat who's in front of you is going to land on their head. And we don't want that. And the funny thing is, every single year this happens. So we don't want to be a means of that. We don't want to be a means of throwing a stone at someone else's head. And that person turns around and says, brother, I'm not shaitan. Shaitan is over there. It's not me. So inshallah, just to avoid that, we try to make sure. So this is Jamarat right here. You will see that there's almost like a balcony there. Almost like a balcony. As you get closer, inshallah, and you are by that, the barrier of the balcony, then inshallah you can throw your stone. And which each time you throw your stone, the seven pebbles you're throwing, which each one you say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Remember, my respected brothers and sisters, that the time frame for Rami is very wasir. At the ending, as we finish off this specific portion, remember, the time frame for Rami, the ulama have made it so much tawsir for it, for you and I, and for our comfort, and for the safety of everyone, that you can inshallah accomplish it, if possible, before Dhuhr Salat, that would be great. If not, before Maghrib inshallah, and even then, if a person is tired, they're feeling sick, they're not feeling well, then inshallah they can also do it after from Maghrib all the way till the next day, Isha. Of course, we do not recommend people to delay it that long with no shari'i udhur, but if a person were to do that, inshallah, it will be still acceptable. My respected brothers and sisters, please remember, do not throw your sandals or valuables or anything like that against the pillars. You are not hurting shaitan anymore than when you throw a small pebble. Remember, this is symbolic, and this is a way that we are disgracing shaitan, and we are basically throwing these rocks against those pillars, which represent symbolically shaitan. Inshallah, we'll go into the details of that from a spiritual lens later on. Now, can we throw on behalf of others? Yes, we can. So if there are people in our group who are weak, who are sick, and who are elderly, the trek for going to Rami will make them more sick, there's a khawf of becoming more sick, a fear of becoming more sick, then inshallah, it is ma'jur and it is rewarding to tell that uncle or aunt or that individual that, you know what, I will take your stone inshallah and I will do it on your behalf. You simply go there inshallah, you will do your own, and then after that inshallah, you will pelt for those individuals as well too. Now let us look at this from a spiritual lens. My respected brothers and sisters, what do the jamarat represent from a spiritual lens? So, as we mentioned before, the jamarat are three different places in which Shaitan tried to dissuade and convince Ibrahim alayhi salam that he should not sacrifice his son. Ibrahim alayhi salam was a prophet of Allah. He knew that this is, I am ma'mur min Allah. Allah has ordered me through a dream to sacrifice my son. He tells his son, my son, I have seen a dream, and in that dream I'm sacrificing you. The son says, Ismail alayhi salam says, Ya abati, oh my father, satatuni insha'Allah min as-sabirin, you will find me among the patient ones, insha'Allah. Don't worry, you go ahead and fulfill the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, some of the tafaseer interestingly mentioned that he told his father when Ismail alayhi salam put him to the blade that, oh my father, you know, wrap a cloth around my eyes and turn my face away because I don't want you to see my face when you're sacrificing me, lest you hesitate and you're unable to fulfill the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. SubhanAllah, look at the level of sacrifice and look at the level of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will never ask you and I to sacrifice our children. Allah will not ask that for us. But what Allah does ask is that we sacrifice our shahawat, we sacrifice those things which cause the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, coming back to the jamarat. So every time the shaitan came, Ibrahim alayhi salam would throw pebbles at him or rocks at him and say, you know what, you know, move away from me, stay away from me, you know, you're not able to convince me. So when we throw that stone, or those pebbles, we are inshallah emulating Ibrahim alayhi salam, the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was throwing pebbles and stones at the shaitan to make the shaitan move away. Now, my respected brothers and sisters, I want you to imagine this, that when you're throwing that stone, remember, shaitan is not hiding behind that stone, neither is he tied or chained there, but this is symbolic. I want you to think to yourself, every time you say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, and you throw that stone and that or that pebble, I want you to imagine all the times, or with each stone, the times in your life Will you know that you slipped from the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Will you know that those times you literally disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the open? Those times where you knew what you were doing was wrong, but you continued to do it. And the whispers of shaitan overpowered you over the injunction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to do that thing. And I want you to think to yourself at that time, basically, as you're doing that, the different weaknesses you have in terms of your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the lack of prayer, the lack of fajr salat, the lack of your transactions being haram, maybe some of the things that you're doing is haram, maybe you're unable to lower your gaze and you keep looking at haram, you touch haram, you are engaged in haram, all of those instances. And as you say Bismillah Allahu Akbar, you're throwing this symbolically as shaitan, and you're saying, Ya Allah, don't let me slip again in this trap of shaitan. And again, Bismillah Allahu Akbar, you take your time, you're imagining this, you're throwing the stone and at the symbolic shaitan, and then you're saying, Ya Allah, don't allow me to fall into this thing again. May Allah give us tawfiq, inshallah, one and all, that as we do our rami, one by one, we are remembering the different times the shaitan entrapped us, and we're making dua to Allah not to be entrapped by shaitan in that same thing again. Ameen, Ya Rabbal Alameen. My respected brothers and sisters, now we move towards the hadi and the sacrifice. So alhamdulillah, I have left Muzdalifah, I have reached Mina, I have done my rami, and now I'm waiting to hear the news of my sacrifice. So hadi in the Arabic language is known as a gift. So we are giving this gift to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah gave me the ability to complete the rites of Hajj. So that's why it's called hadi. It's also called damu shukr. Damu shukr is you're showing gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the fact that He gave you the ability to do Hajj. So inshallah, that's what we are going to do next. My respected brothers and sisters, in the 21st century, generally speaking, I have seldom heard that someone himself or herself goes and sacrifices their own animal. It's just not possible for 2.5 million to 3 million hajjaj to do that in this day and age. So what happens is that the leadership in your group who's taking you, serving you in the Hajj group, they are connected with the abattoir that slaughters these hadis. And some of us, we want a camel slaughter, we've told them that it's camel, or if it's going to be, inshallah, a cow. Once that slaughter is made, they will receive, our group receives an email that we have sacrificed all of the animals needed. You have 100 members here. We have sacrificed all of your animals on your behalf. That certificate in this day and age is our cue that our animal has been sacrificed. People say, oh brother, how can we trust those? What if they're not telling the truth? My respected brothers and sisters, it's not your job to assume and to, subhanAllah, you're just in ihram, you're just coming out of ihram, to have su'ul dhan and to think that people will go and they will lie to you and not tell you that your animal is and lie to you that your animal is sacrificed when it has not been sacrificed. Your job in this day and age, in 21st century, is to make the arrangements for the animals to be sacrificed. That's your job. The animal has been sacrificed, your leadership receives a certificate, an email, letting them know, or a message, the animals for your group has been sacrificed. The leadership of your group will share that on the WhatsApp group, because sometimes we're still in Jamarat, sometimes we're somewhere else, and we will receive it on our WhatsApp group, or our email, or we will find out from the group that our animal has been sacrificed. Once your animal has been sacrificed, my brothers and sisters, you now will be able to come out of ihram after you've done halaq and qasr. But inshallah, before we go into that, let us inshallah look at the sacrifice of the animal from a spiritual point of view. Why is there a sacrifice of an animal? Because when Ibrahim a.s. was sacrificing Ismail a.s., at that point Allah ta'ala replaced Ismail a.s. with a ram from heaven. And Allah, and instead of slaughtering his son, he slaughtered basically the ram. And this is we are reliving that legacy and trying to relive the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And as when we do get a chance in our life during our Eid times, we're not doing Hajj, for example, as we sacrifice that animal, if we do get an opportunity, we think to ourselves, the lesson is, what shahawat, what disobediences, what bad habits do I need to sacrifice for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? SubhanAllah, in our dunya, things that hold us back in our worldly affairs, we will sacrifice certain things that we like because we want to make sure we're in tip-top shape for our dunya, for our job, for our work, for our career. But my question to you is, how many times have we thought about what things, what bad habits, what actions do I have to sacrifice for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that my relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be a better relationship, inshaAllah. May Allah give us tawfiq, one and all. So in summary, inshallah, our hadi will be sacrificed, and once it's sacrificed, inshallah, we will get a notification and our leadership will tell us that your hadi has been sacrificed. After that, inshallah, we will be able to now go we will be able to go, inshallah, and do our qasr and halaq. Before we move on to qasr and halaq or taqsir and halaq, I just want to share with us a hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ in which he spoke about how valuable and how beloved our sacrifice is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on Yawm al-Nahr. Inshallah, before we move towards halaq and taqsir, let us hear a hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ in which he explains to us how virtuous our sacrifice of the hadi is on that day. Rasulullah ﷺ says, "Ma amalu ibn Adam yawm al-nahr ahabu ila Allah min ihraq al-dam wa innahu la yu'ta yawm al-qiyamati bi quruniha wa ash'ariha wa adlafiha wa inna al-dam la yaq'u min Allah bimakanin qabla an yaq'u bil-ard fati." The Prophet says that on the day of Yawm al-Nahr, on the day of Eid, for those who are outside of Hajj, for us, on the day of Yawm al-Nahr, there is no action that is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the sacrifice of the animal, the blood that is spilling from the sacrifice of the animal. On that day, on the day of judgment, it will appear with its horns, its hairs, and its hooves, and indeed the blood will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before the blood even drops onto the earth. So let your heart be delighted by it. My respected brothers and sisters, the meaning of this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we sacrifice that animal before the blood even hits the ground, and what is the distance between the animal and the ground that the blood is going to hit? It's not even a meter, it's not even half a meter. But before that blood hits the ground, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it from us, inshallah. When we do it with ikhlas, and we do it solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah ta'ala will accept this, inshallah, gift in dhamma shukr from us. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts our sacrifice on Yawm al-Nahr. So, my brothers and sisters, after we get the news that our animal has been sacrificed, now it's our time to do halaq and taqsir. So halaq, as we know, we've explained in the past. Inshallah, now we have done speaking about the hadi, we're going to move on to halaq and taqsir. So we've already explained what halaq and taqsir is, and I'm sure by now, inshallah, you know what that is. Halaq is when you shave your head entirely. Taqsir is when you trim it, down. My respected brothers and sisters, we also remember the hadith of Rasulullah when he made three du'a for those basically who did halaq, meaning they shaved their head completely, and he made one du'a for the one who did taqsir. At this point, I want to remind you again, and not going into the details, in one of the videos I mentioned this, people say, "Brother, you know, I'm a lawyer, I'm a doctor, I'm an engineer, I'm a CEO, I'm a businessman, I feel embarrassed to, you know, I feel embarrassed to shave my head completely and go bald." My respected brothers, subhanAllah, in Hajj, you know, we learn that there should be times in my life where I'm able to put my ego and myself aside for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we know that the Prophet ﷺ made three du'as of rahmah and mercy for us, for those who shave their head completely, then why not adopt that option? Of course, in the sharia, this is the ni'mah of Allah and the rahmah of Allah. Allah ta'ala accepts both. If you do taqsir, alhamdulillah, you simply trim your hair and that's good enough. And if you do halaq, alhamdulillah, that's even better. But we should opt for that which is a part of the sunnah and that which is more beloved and close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know 100% that halaq is more beloved to Allah. So may Allah give us tawfiq, inshallah, one and all, to be able to shave our head as soon as possible. Remember, we have to shave our head, inshallah, within the boundaries of the haram. We can do it when we come back to Mina, inshallah. I always advise people, do not share blades. If there are people who are shaving heads out there, usually there is people who are, you can go to them as well too, but we always recommend do not share the blade of anyone else, because you don't know what kind of a disease they have on their head. And we've seen this happen right after Hajj. 2-3 days later, suddenly people's head is hurting. And when they go, and I've seen this time and again, in Umrahs as well too, they have to buy a special cream, and their head becomes extremely sensitive. In the heat, it becomes sensitive, and when they just even touch it. So inshallah, for that reason, to be as safe as possible, use inshallah a new blade, or inshallah you can bring your own blade and you can have someone cut your hair. Some people believe only the person can cut your hair if they have cut their hair already. That's not true. If anyone is cutting each other's hair, that's not a problem inshallah. We can cut our hair inshallah, and we can come out of state of ihram. When we bald our hair, when we shave our head or we cut our hair, we come out of the state of ihram. Everything becomes permissible except for marital relations. Marital relations is not permissible when a person comes out of ihram until they have completed the tawaf al-ifada or tawaf al-ziyara. May Allah give us tawfiq inshallah, one and all. Now, my respected brothers and sisters, we're moving forward inshallah. Taqseer is done or halaq is done, and now we are going towards our tawaf al-ifada or tawaf al-ziyara. At this point, a practical thing to remember. Generally speaking, there are times where buses can be provided, but we see that more often than not, buses are not provided. Buses are not provided by the ministry. It has to do just with their decision, and in terms of crowd control and car control and highway controls, whatever it is. So generally speaking, at this time, people will form small groups, and they'll go in a taxi to go and do their tawaf al-ifada. You don't need to do your tawaf al-ifada the same day. If you want to do your tawaf al-ifada the same day, alhamdulillah. But you don't have to. You can easily do your tawaf al-ifada the next day. Why am I sharing this with you? Remember, we have 2.5 million to 3 million hujjaj who are all at Mina. All of them, or a big majority of them, have done pelting the jamarat. And now they are all coming towards Mecca, and they all want to do their tawaf. Even with the tawsi', even with the expansion of the haram, we have seen that it is extremely, extremely crowded. So if you have your wife with you, your mother with you, your sister with you, we would highly recommend that you go at a time where it's much more calmer, as opposed to going at a time when there is much more of a crowd there. Subhanallah, a brother was explaining to me, and he was telling me that when Allah Ta'ala has given you the ability to take your time in doing certain ibadah, why not take your time? Why not return to your hotel and inshallah, for example, for those who are doing it the same day or even the next day, go to your hotel, take a nice shower, rest a little bit, take a breather, eat something, get some energy, because now you are going to do your tawaf. It's almost tawaf al-ifada, like tawaf al-shukr. You are thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving you the ability to complete the rites of Hajj. So why not go in a fashion or in a manner that you have energy and you're able to do it wholeheartedly? Not like, oh my God, I just can't wait to finish this, because you're feeling tired, you are drenched with sweat. No, inshallah, whether you want to take a shower when you're in Mina, before you go to tawaf al-ifada, and you're taking off your ihram, now you're wearing new clothes, or whether you want to go to your hotel, you go to your hotel, you come out of your ihram, you take a nice shower, you wear nice, comfortable clothes, the best clothes that you have, and then inshallah, for example, after Maghrib, after Isha, when the crowd is less, then you make inshallah your way to the haram, and you do your tawaf al-ifada. My respected brothers and sisters, remember, in tawaf al-ifada, also known as tawaf al-ziyara, there is no ramal, and you can do it in normal clothes as well too. You don't have the restriction of doing the ihram. There is no extra reward for those people who want to do it in their ihram. There is no extra reward. We don't know that from the sunnah. So you might as well get out of your ihram, wear clean clothes, and inshallah, and in your best and most cleanest of clothes, inshallah, you can go do your tawaf al-ifada, also known as tawaf al-ziyara. Tawaf al-ifada and tawaf al-ziyara are also a very, very important part of Hajj. In fact, according to many scholars, there are two arkan of Hajj. One is your wukuf al-arafah, being in Arafah, and the other one is your tawaf al-ziyara, or also known as tawaf al-ifada. So my respected brothers and sisters, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Sharia gives us this ability to be able to delay our tawaf al-ifada, that we can do it inshaAllah from after our halaq, from that time, from the 10th, we can do it all the way till before Maghrib on the 13th, then why not take advantage of that? Again, Allah is giving you this tawsir, Allah is giving you this wus'ah, why not take advantage of it? In fact, one of the dalail for qasr that some of the madhahib use, that if you are traveling and basically you have to pray qasr, they say if you pray 4 rak'ah instead of 2 rak'ah, the Hanafiya madhab say that your 4 rak'ah will not count. You must pray 2 rak'ah. And they say when Allah is giving you the gift of qasr and Allah is giving you this tawsir, you must take advantage of it. So my respected brothers and sisters, of course in this case it's not a must, but Allah Ta'ala is giving you the ability to do your tawaf al-ifada and tawaf al-ziyara from the 10th of Dhul Hijjah all the way to before Maghrib on the 13th of the Hijjah. Why not take advantage of it? Why not be able to do it at your own comfort level so that when you do, as I mentioned before, your tawaf al-ifada, you can do it full of energy inshaAllah and not being tired. May Allah give us inshaAllah tawfiq one and all to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of our ability. So inshaAllah, just to summarize day 3 of Hajj, the 10th of Dhul Hijjah, we go to Mina after Fajr, we perform a rami of the Jamarat, and then we get the news of our hadi, our animal being sacrificed, then we do our halaq or taqseer, then inshaAllah either we can choose to come the day of or the next day or the day after that until before Maghrib the 13th to come inshaAllah to do our tawaf al-ziyara, and after tawaf al-ziyara we'll, of course we'll also be performing our sa'yi. Alhamdulillah, we have explained in much detail already how to do tawaf, how tawaf is done. At the same time also we have explained in much detail already how to do sa'yi. Just remember inshaAllah Allah, that in your tawaf, you don't need to do ramal, neither do you need to ibda', where you're basically going to expose your right arm. That is not necessary because you will not be wearing ihram. You'll be doing this, inshallah, in your normal clothing. And then, after we have done our tawaf al-ifada, we are going to go back, inshallah, to Mina, and we're going to spend our time in Mina for the next couple of days. Inshallah, in the following episode, we are going to speak about ayyam al-tashriq, inshallah. الله.
سأقبل يا خالقي من جديد كما أنت مني إلهي تريد وأرجو إذا أنت تقبلني جنان الخلود ومنك المزيد.